I'm so excited to be with you once again, and it's an honor and privilege that God has given me and my family to be with the children of God in West Plains. We love you all, and I know God has a plan for this church. I'm thankful to God for the time of worship we had today. I thought we were going to miss Sarah, but I'm sure that Jonathan did a wonderful job in explaining that great passage to us. And shall we give him a And I really loved the singing. Yesterday I was in St. Louis, and we were in a Telugu group. And when Telugu songs were sung, I said that was the best way to learn a language, when you hear a song in that language. And I wish yesterday, I was just sitting there and thinking, how I wish I could hear a Spanish song. Ah. And the very next day I heard one.
Amen.
Now I'm interested in Spanish. I want to welcome all of you for this morning service, those who have come for the first time and those who have come after a long time, and those who are committed to this church in growing along with the people of God here. I'm happy that Merlin is there with us today this morning. God bless him and his family. I want to thank God for his mercies that he has given each one of us in the last week. And I want to thank God that Psalm 139 came life when Swapna shared that this morning. A very short but the sweet word of God, where it says, Lord, you've searched me and known me. You know us, my downsitting and my uprising. And the understanding, my thought is afar off. Thou knowest my path, my lying down, and are acquainted with my ways. God knows everything that is, every word in my tongue, he knows. He knows everything. He has. There's nothing in our life which he doesn't know. Wherever we go, he knows. And the beautiful thing in that is, I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. And my substance is not hidden from me. God knows everything, and there's nothing hidden from him. He knows from inside out. And how precious are your thoughts unto me, O God, and how great is the sum of them. How precious is God's thoughts for each one of us this morning, and how precious, how great is the sum of them. You know, God is thinking, and there are so many thoughts for us. I think we must go back and study and meditate Psalm 139, which was read this morning earlier. And I hope that will encourage all of us. And beautiful Psalm, wonderful Psalm, to realize that we are fearfully, wonderfully made. And I want to encourage you that as families together, those who are coming alone here for worship, I pray that 2015, all the families will come here.
Amen.
Because Satan is fighting against the families in America. And we are going to pray and fight against Satan's work. And we believe that families should be united, and they should be here together to praise God.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. We came a victory on such that particular matter.
Amen.
And I want to thank God that God is going to do that for us. For this morning's meditation, shall we turn to John's Gospel. And we are going to go to chapter 5. John's Gospel, chapter 5. Can somebody help me with that portion, please? John's Gospel, chapter 5.
Some time later, Jesus went up to Jerusalem for a feast of the Jews.
Yes.
Now, there is in Jerusalem...
What is there in Jerusalem?
Near the sheep gate, a pool.
A pool near the sheep gate.
Which is in Aramaic, is called Bethesda.
Bethesda. There was a pool in Jerusalem. Jerusalem is a city of God. And near the sheep gate, there was a pool called Bethesda. There was something very special about this pool. This pool is a healing pool. What happened every year? What happened there?
Here a great number of disabled people used to lie.
There a great number of disabled people lie. Wherever there is healing, sick people come. Praise God. Church is meant for healing. Amen. So we should have a whole lot of people who are needy coming in every Sunday. Because this is the place where healing happens.
Amen.
This is the place where deliverance happens.
Yes.
This is not for people who are right, but this is for people who are in trouble.
Amen.
Jesus said, I came for the sick. I came to seek out the sinner, the lost ones. There are so many lost in this city. There are so many struggling. Today morning, if there is somebody who is sick among us, there's going to be healing.
Amen.
Because church is the place of healing.
Amen.
Today is the day of salvation.
Amen.
What all healing? Healing spiritual, healing physical, healing emotional, healing mental, healing relationships.
Amen.
All kinds of healing has to happen.
Amen.
And it's going to happen this morning. Amen. I believe God is here and God is going to touch all of our lives. If there is some weakness, if there is some disease that is there in us, it has to be healed. Some of us have some disease like, you know, you've heard about cancer, which is incurable. Radiation, chemotherapy doesn't really do even surgery. It keeps growing and growing and growing and growing. This kind of disease is there spiritually. Some addictions, some problems in relationship. However much you try to heal it, it just keeps growing. You want to rectify it. You want to have a deliverance. But it's like cancer, it's inside. Only God can heal that.
Amen.
Only God can rectify that. And this place in Jerusalem, the pool of Bethesda, had that healing power.
Amen.
Let this church be known in West Plains as Bethesda.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. As a place of healing where people are going to just flock together. Glory to God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You know, Jesus said once, you are the light of the world.
We are.
We are not the light of West Plains. We are the light of the
world.
We can hardly light up our own house, imagine. And he says, you are the light of the world. The darkness in our house is still remaining. We are not even getting the darkness of our life. House go. You are the light of the world. Just say to yourself this morning that you are the light of the world. You are the light of the world. We are the light of the world. Jesus was the light. He's the light of the world. Hallelujah. And let me tell you, light has speed, it has got power, it clears up darkness, it does a lot of miracles. Hallelujah.
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 And God has kept us as the light of this place. And the light should not be hidden. Many of us are lights, but we are under the bushel. Nobody knows that we have lights. We don't want to be seen, you know, we want to be hidden. We want to somewhere cozy, slowly stay. No. God wants you to be seen by everyone.
Amen.
If you are the light of the world, you should be on the mountaintop. Let this church be visible in the town that everybody sees and knows. And at the time of trouble, sickness, they know where is a place to go.
Amen.
There is a healing pool. And that's why the whole lot of people came. And here was something that was happening that day. Shall we turn back to the word? What happened?
One who was there had been an invalid for 38 years.
There was a man with an infirmity for 38 years in that pool, waiting for his day of healing. Can you imagine? Somebody waiting for 38 years? He must have had an awful lot of patience. Praying for 38 years. If I was in that position, after 10 years, I would have said, "Buzz, I would have given up. I'm not going to pray for this issue anymore. I had it. I've been praying for so long.
Yeah.
You know, I've been praying for my husband, I've been praying for my wife, I've been praying for my children, I've been praying for this problem, that problem, for 10 years. That's long enough, nothing has happened, I'm going to stop praying. Yeah, I'm sure you guys are much better than me, you may pray for 15 or 20 years.
Yeah.
But think of 38 years, isn't that long enough for waiting?
Yes.
Whew! 38 years for a miracle in his life. He was invalid, couldn't walk, lying there. It made me think, what made him wait in that place for 38 years? You know, every year he saw a miracle. So his hope kindled. I'm sure when I see somebody new coming into church or something happens on that Sunday, I know the church is alive. I know that Jesus is working. I know a healing is there. So every year, he was excited to see this. So the testimonies and the miracles of the year made him wait there for his day. You can wait for 30 years or 20 years or 10 years, it doesn't matter. But make sure you're waiting in the right place. Don't go and sit in the wrong place and wait for it. If you're in the right place and you're waiting, your day of miracle is going to come.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
If you are in Jerusalem, the city of God, If you are in Bethel, the house of God, the place of God, and if you are near Bethesda, the pool of healing, you will be healed one day. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Make sure you are in the right place.
Amen.
Hallelujah. If you are in the right place, the right time will come. Glory to God. I'm sure this day is a day of healing. If there is somebody listening to the message this morning who is sick inside, God doesn't want you to be sick. Whatever disease it may be, I'm not bothered what the disease is. Don't get frightened by the name of the disease. Some of us think that God can only heal flu and diarrhea. He cannot heal big things. God can heal any disease.
Amen.
Hallelujah. However bad it is, however long it is, however terrible it is. Some of us think that only when we cry and pray, God knows the meaning of the problem. Oh Lord, you know, it's terrible. When you say what the problem is, He knows even before you say. He knows the problem of your family. He knows the problem of your life. I'm not against crying. I'm not upset about your tears, because your tears are valuable in the presence of God. Some of you believe that you became valuable after the cross. No, you are valuable. That is why Jesus came on the cross. You are made precious not through the cross. You are precious in the sight of God. God loves you as you are.
Amen.
Hallelujah. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him shall not perish but have everlasting life.
Amen.
You are precious.
Hallelujah.
But you become powerful in Jesus. You become eternal in Jesus.
Amen.
You become complete in Jesus.
Amen.
Being precious is not enough. Being wanted is not enough. Being loved is not enough. You have to be more than that.
Amen.
You have to be complete in Jesus.
Amen.
You have to be united with Jesus.
Amen.
You need to be empowered by the power of the Holy Ghost.
Amen. Amen.
That is what we need.
Yes.
Whatever that is lacking in our life should be gone by the power of the Holy Spirit. If there is any weakness, any sickness, any problem in our character, anything that God wants to change, church is the place when you come and sit and pray, God is going to transform you.
Amen.
Holy Spirit is a power that transforms us. Each day when you walk with God, you are being transformed.
Amen.
For 38 long years, this man waited for his day of miracle. I know this morning somebody has been waiting for the day of your miracle. And let me say, today is the day of your miracle.
Amen.
I believe that today is the day of your miracle. Can you believe with me?
Amen.
Will you believe with me?
Yes.
That today is the day of your miracle, and then you will receive the miracle in your family, the miracle in your personal life.
Amen.
Today is the day. Why? We read the next thing. Why was that day the miracle day? What happened?
When Jesus saw him lying there.
Jesus saw him lying there. That's all you need. Once Jesus sees you, your day of miracle has come. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus saw him. That is enough. Today Jesus is seeing you as you are, where you are, who you are, and what the problem is. Jesus saw him lying there. All these years, so many others saw him lying here. No use if others see you lying there. But when Jesus sees you lying there,
hallelujah,
there is a great use. Hallelujah.
That's right.
Jesus saw him lying there, and what happened?
And learned that he had been in this condition for a long time.
And he knew that he was in this condition for a long time. Jesus knows your condition. He also knows how long you have been there.
That's right.
Hallelujah. You heard my wife telling you the testimony this morning, that we had a big struggle in getting our birth certificates in our country. There was no record of that time. In fact, her birth certificates was missing. Nobody knew where she was born.
Mm.
Even her relatives who were alive who didn't know whether she was born in Tiruvalla, the city where I live, Kottayam, or her city, Pathanamthitta. We tried so many towns and there was no record. But Bible says every day of our life is recorded in heaven.
Amen.
Even before we were born. Until the last day, God knows. God knew I was going to be in West Plains in 2015 for a month, even before 10 years back. Hallelujah. God knows everything in our life. God knows everything about you. Nothing is hidden from you. Him.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Isn't that interesting?
Yes.
God knew that he was lying there for a long time. Sometimes we tell God, do you really understand? Do you know what situation I'm going through? Sometimes we question him. We ask him, does he really know my family situation, my children's situation, my financial situation, how my husband and my wife and all are? He knows. He knows very well. He knew he was lying there for such a long time. And then what happened? He saw him. He knew that his problem. Then what happened? What happened next?
Jesus asked him
a question. What was the question?
Do you want to get well?
Do you want to get well? What a question to ask. For 38 years I have been lying there. For what? I was not daydreaming. I didn't lie here to see some movies. I didn't come to watch miracles in other people's life. I have been lying here for 38 years for my miracle. And Jesus is asking, do you want to be healed?
Amen.
He is asking, what a question. This morning God wants to ask you, do you want a change in your life? Do you want a rectification in your family life? Do you really want? He cannot work in your life without your want and willingness. Jesus says, I stand at the door of your heart and knock. Whoever opens the door, I will come in. Some of us have tightly put the bolts and Jesus is knocking. No. Because we know some things are inside the hearts.
Yes.
And if Jesus has to come in, we have to get this thing out first. So we don't want it to come. Yes, Jesus, you be around. Like my genie, as we heard. In times of trouble, I will call you. But don't take control of my life. That's too much. I control my life, you help in between. 50-50. No! He wants an absolute surrender. He wants a total commitment. He wants you to be your Lord and Savior. He wants to be in your heart.
Amen.
He wants to be your everything.
Yes.
Do you want a healing? Do you want a fresh touch? Do you want your family to be rectified? You want your healing happens? You really want?
Yes.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
What a question to ask. Is it a sensible question to ask for a man who's been lying there for 30 years? 38 years? Yes, it's very relevant. We see that many times God is asking, what do you want? Jesus always asks before a miracle, what do you want? What do you want? He wants to know the inner heart. God asked Solomon, what do you want? I want to give you one gift. If I was in Solomon's place, I would have asked something else. I would have said, I want riches, or I want fame, or name, or I don't know what I would have asked. He asked for wisdom and God gave him everything else free.
That's right.
You ask the right things, the rest comes free.
That's right.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
And for that, you need to know the will of God. Some of us, we ask the wrong things and then nothing comes free. And we waste a chance to get our answer. Today, let's listen to God's voice and ask the right thing. What happened next? What happened?
Sir, the invalid replied.
The invalid replied?
I have no one to help me into the pool.
He did not ask all these explanations. He said, do you want to be healed? You say yes or no?
Yes.
That's a question he asked. Very simple question. Was it not a difficult question? It was like most of the questions in medical entrance and engineering and all are difficult. This is not a very difficult question that Jesus asked. Was it a difficult question?
No.
He said, do you want to be healed? Simple answer, yes or no. Isn't that interesting? But did he give an answer straightforward?
No.
He is beating around the bush. He said, no one to help me.
Excuses.
This is what happens to all of us. Do you want your family to be rectified? Then you look at the husband. Wife looks at the husband. Husband looks at the wife. Do you what? Do you want to be healed? Then you looked at the doctor. You look at the medicine bottle. Do you want a fresh touch of the Holy Spirit?
Yes.
Then you look at the pastor. You look at the number of the people around. Do you want an anointing?
Yes. Yes, amen.
Then you look around.
Amen.
You have a lot of excuses. Are you ready for a fresh touch from Jesus today?
Amen.
Very simple question.
Yes, Lord.
Very straightforward question. Yes or no?
Yes, Lord.
He is like us. See, God asked Eve, Adam, did you eat from the tree? Adam didn't say yes or no. He said, she gave it to me. How we put the blame on the other person, no? The question he is answering, yes or no, he is putting the blame on the whole world. Sir, I have no man to help. When I went to learn MBBS, my physiology professor taught me one good lesson. The helping hand you're looking for is at the end of your own two arms. The helping hand you're looking for is at the end of your own two arms. There's no one to help me in, put me into the water. We blame others for our situation all the time. There's no revival, not because of me, it's because of the other person. You come and sit here and pray from the beginning, revival will happen automatically. We need to change. We need to surrender. We need to commit. The question is in us.
Amen.
Amen.
I'm sure this fellow is a very smart fellow. That's why he waited for 38 years. He's not an ordinary guy. I'm also sure he must have had his own plans. I'm just thinking retrospectively. He must have told some guy, see, come on, when you get healed, you stay back and push me next year. And I'm sure some other guys would have agreed also for this pushing business. And they got healed. Then suddenly they remembered that they have to finish building their house. They said, I'll come back in the next year, same time, and I'll push you. Let me go finish my house and come. And gone and never came back. So that is why he's blaming, because he has previous experience.
Mm-hmm.
He had already arranged some people for pushing. 10 years he must have made alliance with communication and networking for his smartness, for his business. He thinks that is the way how it works. Because he knew he couldn't do it himself. So all that, he was looking for other people. Things that you cannot do today, you are not going to look for a human help. You are going to look for a divine help.
Amen.
Who is going to push you to something which you have never done before.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
All these 38 years, he depended on others to push him into the pool. And one guy was a very sincere fellow whom he had arranged. And he waited till the last minute, the month before the angel came. But what happened? His daughter was getting married and he had to go away. Some of us are too busy that we don't go for gospel meetings. We don't evangelize. We get salvation, that is enough. Let the other invalid remain near the pool. Who is there to push? We don't want to push anyone. I'm happy with my salvation. I'm happy with my family. See, many people come to church for healing. Have you ever seen them coming back after healing? No, many people go away. 10 lepers were healed. Only one came back to thank God.
Yes.
If all the people who were touched by the power of the Holy Spirit comes back for worship, this place wouldn't be enough.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
The healing people all went. Nobody came back to see the pool again. Nobody came back to see anyone. This morning, I'm telling you, Jesus is standing right there in front of you and asking you a question. Do you want to be healed?
Amen.
Don't make excuses. Today is the day of your healing. So if I was in Jesus' position, since he had made a request, okay, come on, I will help you. After all, you've been here for 38 years. Now is the time to push you. I know how to make this situation ready. I have handled such problems even before. No, we try to handle and help others with our knowledge. We'll make a mess out of it. Don't put your hand in other people's life. Allow the Holy Spirit to work.
Amen.
Only the Holy Spirit can heal a broken relationship.
That's right.
Only a Holy Spirit can heal a sick man.
Amen.
I repeat again, I know how to operate, but it is God who heals.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
No doctor in the world knows how to heal a disease. If that was the thing, then there, you don't need a graveyard. All would be healed. If the hospitals were that perfect, then you don't need resuscitation and DC shock and all. You don't need life support system. We struggle a lot. It is God who heals.
Amen.
It is God who gives life. It's God who does everything, and we must realize He's working here today.
Thank you, Lord.
This is the pool of Bethesda. This is where the healing is.
Amen.
All we need to know is publicize to the city that there is healing here.
Thank you.
Isn't that interesting that we are going to have a healing seminar next month? Isn't that interesting that the people who are here right now are going to be the volunteers? Isn't that going to be interesting that you are going to touch people and pray for them and healing is going to happen?
Yes. Amen.
Yes. Yes.
Isn't that interesting that God is preparing us for a great day of miracle?
Amen.
Today I believe that some of you are going to be touched.
Thank you.
Emotional, physical, mental Amen. Sickness Amen. Will flee away.
Yes. Amen.
By his stripes you are healed.
Amen.
It's already done. Praise the Lord. In faith you declare it.
Yes.
And seeds. You will see the miracle. In faith, you declare it. What did Jesus say?
Then Jesus said to him,
yeah.
Get up, pick up your mat and walk.
That is the word of faith. Get up, pick up the mat and walk. Last week, I happened to meet Marlon and I shook hands with him and I said, I will see you on Sunday. And I'm so happy he's here.
Amen.
Your word of faith has so much of power. Thank you, brother, for coming. It has encouraged me so much that you are here with me to worship my Jesus.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
You speak the word of faith, things are going to happen. Mountains are going to move.
Yes.
You are suspecting, you are doubting, you are questioning. Will he come? What will happen? Will the situation change? You know my daughter, she is not capable. My son, you know he has that problem. Stop saying all this nonsense. Hallelujah. Nothing is difficult by God.
Amen.
All things are possible through my Jesus.
Amen.
There is no situation that is not redeemable by my power of the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
And I know God is working in this church. I know God is going to put
yes.
fire here.
Yes.
There is going to be fire.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
That's right.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
I can
Thank
see it
Lord.
In the eyes of faith.
Thank you, Lord.
That things are going to happen. Miracles happening, fire falling, people
yes.
being changed, city yes. on life for God.
Hallelujah.
Indonesia, which is a Muslim city, town, country, has 20% Christians after the tsunami that happened a few years back. In China, which is a closed country, big revival is happening. If it's happening in China and in Indonesia, it's going to happen in West Plains.
Amen.
I believe West Plains is far better. There are so many people of God who are praying for a revival.
Hallelujah.
Who are here right now with me, looking forward to miracles and healing. Waiting too long. You have been waiting too long. 38 years is too long. Why do you need to wait too long? You don't need to wait too long.
Amen.
My Jesus is there today to heal you. Stop saying excuse and just believe him.
Thank
you. He didn't listen to the excuse. He didn't fall for the excuse. He didn't support the excuse. He didn't encourage the excuse. But he gave him the word of faith and said, get up.
Amen.
Get up.
Amen.
And walk. Not only get up and walk, take up your bed also in addition. Oh, my goodness. The bed that has been making you lie for 38 years, the same problem, put it on your head and walk. I thought, why this problem? Why give him more burden? Taking up the bed and walk. Because if you walk without taking the bed, nobody will see. He would have walked in the crowd and gone. But when he walks with the bed out of the place, people are going to see him. God wants you to be spectacular in your healing.
Yes.
Here is a hydrocephalic baby, good for nothing fellow, who would have been rejected in the world, mentally, physically retarded. God made him a neurosurgeon to take up the bed and walk
yes.
so that the world will know that Jesus is alive.
Amen.
He is still working on me. Is he working on you?
Thank you, Lord.
Yes.
Taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who trusts in him.
Yes.
Young lions will grow hungry, but they that seek the Lord will never fail.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Today, some miracles are going to happen in your life,
Amen.
In your family.
Amen.
Just believe it and receive it.
Amen.
You are
Amen.
Going to see the hand of God.
We receive it from
Amen.
God.
Take up the bed and walk. If I was in this position, see the legs, 38 years have not been walking. What would have happened? The legs would have become so scrawny, like broomstick.
Yeah.
No muscles. You have not walked for 38 years. How can you suddenly get up? Then I would have said, Jesus, give me a few days. I would go to Kerala Ayurvedic Center and have some massage and have some muscle building and then try walking. I know you healed me, but let me do some physiotherapy first. You know, make sure that it is all working. I know you have touched my family. I know you have touched my children. I know you have touched my life. But let me just make sure. You know, he would have looked at the leg. The two scrawny broomstick legs, which has been telling him for the 38 years that you will never walk. Your problem is staring at you. Your bed is speaking to you. Your legs are talking to you, saying, you will never walk, man. The sickness, the swelling, the disease, the sugar, the cholesterol, the heart problem, the cancer, which stares at you. Look at it and say, I'm going to walk.
Amen. Amen.
Speak to the problem.
Yes. That's right.
Speak to your leg. You know, look at the thing and have the courage and faith that things are going to change. He looked at it. I'm sure he looked at it when he said, get up and walk. And he looked at Jesus like this. And I'm sure what Jesus did. You know, today he's doing that to you. I had enough of you. You've been sitting here for 38 years. Come on.
Amen.
You don't need a helping hand. That's what he was looking for. See, when Peter was sinking, he did not say, walk and come to me. He immediately stretched his hand. Here he did not stretch his hand. Because this guy was looking for a helping hand. When you are invalid, looking for others to validate you, he wants you to validate yourself and get out of your invalidity.
Amen.
Come on.
Amen.
God wants to move you to action.
Amen.
You don't act and you want things to rectify? No. Throw out what is not pleasing to God. You have to act. The act of faith. You have to pick up the bed. You have to decide to get up on your weak legs. And the muscles will grow immediately.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Close your eyes today to the situation and believe that God has already done the miracle. Don't look at the problem that is staring to you and believe that you are completely healed. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise
hallelujah.
God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Say hallelujah, miracle is already on you. In praising God there is deliverance. The secret of deliverance is praising God. Hallelujah.
Yes. Hallelujah.
Yes, as much as you can praise God, just praise God. That's hallelujah. Devil doesn't like when you praise God.
Right.
Hallelujah. And if you praise God, your situation will automatically change.
Right.
Prayer and praise has to go side by side.
Yes.
Worship has to go together. Praise has to be there all the time. You don't wait for the last minute of the message to get the healing. Get it during the message.
Thank you. Yes.
From the beginning of the worship, let the healing flow. Because you are in Bethesda.
Thank you.
You are in the center of God's will.
For the healing.
You are where you are need to be. Once you come to the church where you need to be, rest is God's business. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
He's asking you to rise up, take up the bed, and walk. Three things. Rise up, take up the bed, and walk. All three things, it's impossible for him. Unimaginable for him. Questionable for him. And what did he do?
At once, the man was healed.
At once! Immediately! Today, immediately, things are happening in this place and in your life. At once, what happened?
The man was cured.
The man was cured.
He picked up his mat and walked.
He picked up his mat
and
walked. If we were the ones, anyway, I've got healed. Let me go home, bring a truck and then picking up the mat and all high weightlifting problem. He has told me to take the bed, but he didn't tell me to take it today. I will rise today. I will walk today. But picking up the bed, I will do tomorrow. We adjust situation to God's command, no? We make things convenient. Means We will leave certain sins today, certain commandments today. The rest we will obey later, step by step. When God told Hannah to give Samuel to God's work as a prophet, she could have sent him to the temple after he finished his schooling. She could have even given him a theology degree and sent him. But she didn't wait. As soon as he was weaned of milking, when the need of the mother was over, she took him and handed over to the temple. You have to do immediately all what God requires.
Yes.
Don't keep it for tomorrow. Three things, do it together. Get up, rise up, take up the bed, and walk.
Amen.
Don't do two partial. Okay, rise up and walk, or rise and... No, do everything together. Rise up, get up, take up the bed, and walk. All three he did. Then what happened?
The day on which this took place was a Sabbath.
Oh, Jesus had forgotten. Those days we didn't have some calendar and all, watch and all to tell whether it was Saturday, Sunday. So Jesus had no idea. So probably he made a mistake, right? No, he knew very well what? That was a Sabbath day. Why did he ask him to pick up that bed? To break the misconception of the so-called religious people who are there. Amen?
Amen.
You can say an amen to it.
Amen.
Because there are so many Pharisees looking right now. They don't like all things to happen suddenly. You know, they want some religious laws to be fulfilled.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
When I was in finally a middle school, there was a guy called George. He was a drug addict. He had two bodyguards, security. He used to inject drugs, had rifles. Failed 8 to 10 times and he was in final year. I was in my balcony and I was studying in med school. I saw this guy coming pitch drunk under addiction of drugs. With his hand, bare hand, he broke open all the notice boards in the hostel like this, the glasses, and he was pleading. And he challenged, who is there in this hostel to come speak against me? I am the Dada of this place. He's from my state, Kerala, and we were in Punjab, far up in north, and he had got in a lot of trouble. My heart moved. I said, Lord, give me the grace to speak to this guy. I told my friends, I am moving next to George in the next month, allocation of the rooms. They said, are you crazy? I said, I am. They said, we are not coming. I said, I need you to come with me. The room next to him is always free. Three of them are free because nobody picks up that area. So it's very easy to get those rooms. We got the rooms and three of us went there. First day I went to his room, he couldn't even speak. His language was not clear. He was, why are you here? So I couldn't even understand what he was saying because he was that doped. It took me 3 months to understand what he's speaking. It took more than 6 months for him to have trust in me. But I can tell you, all his friends left, his gun left, his drugs left. He started coming for prayer with us.
Thank you, Lord. Right. Hallelujah.
You know, when I started walking with him, my believer friends and the church and the community told me, Kovoor George is backsliding. He walks with that man who nobody wants to walk. I wouldn't encourage you, all of you, to do that, because sometimes some of you will walk and walk with like him and with him. That's a danger if you walk with such guys.
Yeah.
Book of Jude tells you very clearly, when you go to catch somebody from fire, make sure that your clothes will not be burnt.
Yes. Amen.
I knew that nothing can catch me, and I asked for God's protection, and I've taken two friends with me.
Yes.
Let me cut the story short. God completely changed him, and in final year, we were writing exams together.
Thank you, Lord.
And I was finishing my medicine examination. I finished my case and I saw this guy sweating and shivering and shaking and, you know, very worried. I went to him and I said, why are you so upset? He said, I'm going to fail. I said, you're not going to fail. This time you're writing with Jesus. Till now you are, no, I have failed 8 to 10 times. I said, you will never fail again. Jesus is with you.
Amen.
Then he told me, you know, the same examiner who came last time is here, who failed me. I said, never mind, even if the devil comes, he's going to pass you. But Jesus is with you. Nobody can fail you. Nobody can fail you!
Amen.
If Jesus is with you,
Amen.
Nobody can touch you if Jesus is in your family. Once your prayer life is rectified, once your personal relationship with Jesus is rectified, once you start believing the word of God, no one can touch.
Amen.
You know, the whole community changed and they started speaking. Now George is walking, the other fellow, is walking with this Kovoor to pass exams and impress professors. Drug addict, who was going to die in life, got saved. People had no good words to speak about him. He's trying to impress professors, apparently. Let me tell you the story very short. He passed all exams that year. Right now, he's been living in America for the past so many years, married as a wonderful physician doing emergency medicine. He was in Boston many years. 2 years back, he has left to Detroit. He is a man of God. I spoke to him last week again.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
My Jesus is alive.
Yes.
Amen.
He is working in people. There are so many desperate souls in West Plains who need to be rectified. Will you go out and engage with them and give your energy, give the gospel of Jesus Christ and share the love and mercy and help people to be saved? There are many broken families in West Plains. Will you be the one who is going to pray and reach out to them? There are so many sick people in West Plains. God wants the church to move and touch them and heal them.
Amen.
Don't be inclusive. Don't be a country club, as we heard. Go out and seek the kingdom of God.
Amen.
Jesus knew that was a Sabbath, and he had asked them to make. Let's come to the last final point. What happened then?
And so the Jews said to the man who had been healed,
yeah,
it is the Sabbath. The law forbids you to carry your mat.
Can you imagine? 38 years this fellow was lying there. I would have expected them to say, wow, how did you get healed? Who healed you? When did this happen? So nice. We are happy for you. Did anyone say we are happy for you?
No.
They were so upset. They would have been happy if he was drunk and lying there. The world is happy when you are addicted. The world is happy when you are broken. Have you seen people drinking? I have seen, at least in my college and the place where I am, they'll make the other fellow pitch drunk and they will start laughing. You know? They laugh when others fall. People don't like when somebody grows.
No.
But in brokenness, they all laugh.
Yes.
They enjoy.
Uh-huh.
Church will not. We are people who are touched by the love of God.
Amen.
When we see a broken person, we cry inside.
Amen.
We have the same feeling as Jesus has.
Yes.
The love of the cross is in us. We cannot tolerate somebody going down.
Amen.
God has called us for such people, to save such people. The Jews had nothing good to say. They said, today is Sabbath. Don't you know that it is not lawful to carry bed? They were only worried about laws and regulations and all other kind of stuff. They were not worried about healing or power or God's touch. I want to talk to you about grace above all law. I'm not saying break laws, but I want to talk about love above all laws. When God does wonderful things for you, which is not actually what you deserve, you don't mind. But when God does something wonderful to somebody else which he doesn't deserve, you say, you know, really, he doesn't deserve that. I know of a friend of mine who told me once, in 96, when I was coming to US, my US visa was denied first time. And then somehow I got it within 1 month because I had to attend a conference, a workshop in St. Louis. And one of my best friends, he said, I've been watching you for the last 25, 30 years. God really loves you and does miracles for you. But I know you don't really deserve it. I said, yes, I also know. Brother, I don't deserve it. I don't deserve anything that God has given me over the years.
Thank you, Lord.
He's been so faithful to me. That's why I'm grateful to him. I don't deserve anything.
Right.
It's his grace. It's his love. It's his mercy. And I want to share that with everyone. Not that I deserve. not because I am pious, not because I am righteous, but he loves me.
Amen.
We heard that today. His favor is somewhere we don't understand. I never will understand. Even when I see him face to face, I won't know why he loved me so much in my life.
Thank you, Lord.
More than anyone else I have seen, God has loved me so much. You know, you can't understand because a mentally retarded hydrocephalic baby living a normal life, having a family and enjoying everything in the world is something impossible.
Amen.
Only God can do that. No shunt surgery, no doctor, no medicine can ever do that. And I know and I believe that the same Jesus is going to heal people here.
Amen.
And I'm going to see before I go back to India.
Yes.
Miracles happening.
Yes.
I believe when I came to West Plains, I said, Lord, send fire with me.
Hallelujah.
I want to take fire.
Amen.
I want to take fire.
Hallelujah.
I want to take the power of God. I want to take healing and I want to see it with my own eyes.
Hallelujah.
I want to thank you, Jesus, because you are going to do it.
Yes, Lord. Yes. Amen.
Amen.
I want to be in the center of God's will where he's moving.
Yes, Lord.
They questioned him. Then if this question was to me, I would have been shattered or I would have been irritated or I would have got even angry. What do you think, you said? I was lying for 38 years, now I am walking, what the hell? I would have got angry. This man, even though he was saved and born again only one day, he was more gentle than me because he was such a broken spirit. He was not arrogant. He did not criticize them. He did not judge them. He did not question them. He did not speak anything evil against them. Who questioned him, his healing, his walking, and his power to lift the bed? They were questioning all these things. The world will question your power. The world will question the miracle. The world will question the way you are walking. But don't get baffled. Don't get irritated. You don't get upset. He wasn't. He was a one-day-old believer. But he was a broken soul. He was such a crushed spirit. He had nothing to retort back. He had a simple answer. What was the answer?
But he replied.
He replied.
The man who made me well said to me.
The man who made me well said to me.
Pick up your mat and
pick
walk.
All I know is that the man who healed me told. What a simple answer. All I know is that the man who told me, who healed me, told me to pick up the mat. All I know that Jesus told me that I should share his love till the end of my life. All I know that he will never leave me nor forsake me.
Yes,
all I know is that he's going to come back soon. All I know that every day of my life I will worship him.
Amen.
All I know is that I will continue to glorify him. I'm going to conclude and pray for you. What happened next? The most interesting thing. What happened?
So they asked him, who is this fellow who told you to pick it up and walk?
That whom asked you to walk. Next.
The man who was healed had no idea who he was.
He had no idea of who he was.
For Jesus had slipped away into the crowd that was there.
Jesus went off without even revealing who he was. Some of us get touched and healed, but we don't get any idea of our healer. That is where the problem is. We need to really know who Jesus is. Once you are touched by his love, don't run away. Wait till you have a revelation.
Amen.
You need to know who healed you. Because when people question you, at least you should know who touched your life. He had no idea. Jesus slipped away and he was also so excited with taking the mat and walking, he forgot everything about it. He was so happy that he didn't have a second look at Jesus. He was hurrying to take up his bed and run home and show everybody.
Amen.
He forgot to have a second look at the man who healed him. He did not follow him. If some of you are very nice, you know, you would have forgotten the everything and said bed and walked behind him. He didn't walk behind him. He was so excited that he wanted to go home. But then what happened?
Later, Jesus found him at the temple and said to him.
Jesus went back to him. There is a time of revelation when Jesus comes back to you after a healing. After a deliverance, if you wait for him, If you look for him and if you stay for him, if you have the desire in your heart, he will come in search of you. He came back for him. He came back to speak to him. He came back to reveal, because Jesus knew when people questioned him, he had no idea who he was. He came back to him and he said,
See, you are well again.
You are well again.
Stop sinning. Or something worse may happen to you.
That is the final message. You are well now. Don't go back to your old ways. Stop sinning. Don't repeat the mistakes you have done before. Jesus has touched you and healed you. Be whole and remain with him.